working hard to bring together people who are interested in how to commercialize their science, but also other kinds of startups. I've worked with startups all my career, and really very keen to see what can be done to raise the conversation around these kinds of activities around here. So I'm partnered tonight with Les Newman from ICANN New York, who runs a virtual incubator for the last 15 years, focused on clean tech and other types of tech that he can tell you more about himself. And with Dan Pataki, who runs Finis Ventures, an advisory firm for growing companies, both doing really great work in our region. And the way the event will run tonight, then I'll stop talking, is we have some company presenters who are going to tell us about their big idea, their journey to entrepreneurship, how they got where they are, or how they got their idea, where they're headed. And we have these four wonderful panelists who have agreed to give us their time. Most of them are either entrepreneurs or advisors to entrepreneurs or both. And they will share some thoughts and suggestions and feedback. And then, of course, everyone will have a chance to ask some questions and mingle around. So I hope it'll be a great conversation. Thank you all for coming. And Les and Dan, do you want to say a word or two before Kara gives her presentation?
Hi, my name is Les Newman. I'm the current managing director of ICANN New York. We've been here in the Hudson Valley as the only incubator to help open BioLink back in 2014. We've been here since 2005. Our focus is on technology, IT, clean tech, energy. And we've helped hundreds of companies within the time that we've been around. And we've been doing these events various locations since then, and I think the association with BioLink has been a tremendous opportunity for us to broaden our brand and expand our geography. Meeting with Deborah and BioLink is a privilege, and it's a great space to have this event. I remember when we were here for the grand opening, and we had it out there, with hundreds of people around here, but I didn't get to see the space as well. It's great. Don't need to say a whole lot more. I think what we'd like to do is have our investors or our panelists introduce themselves, say a few words, who they are, what they do, and then I'll turn it over to Danny and we can go from there. Scott, why don't you start?
I'll do the honors. Good evening, everybody. My name is Scott Brenner, and I'm an attorney. Worked originally with a large firm handling primarily commercial matters globally. Began to focus on smaller business entrepreneurs, venture capital, et cetera. I've been doing that ever since, probably for the last 25 years.
My name is Hugh Schwartz, and what I do these days is commercialize late-stage startups. I've been doing that for about 15 years now. Started my career actually Fortune 500 companies, Procter & Gamble, and then American Pizza, Tiffany products for one division of Procter, and the president of another division of Procter.
And
if
you
want
to repeat it?
Everybody hear me?
No. Now we can.
Okay, I'll do it real quick then. I'll do it backwards. As I said, I'm Hugh Schwartz. Right now what I do is commercialize late-stage startups. That's my primary business. I've got a few partners that help me do that. And I started my career for the first 20 years or so in Fortune 500 companies in consumer goods, Procter & Gamble, and American Pizza. So I started doing a new part of that.
Hi everybody, I'm Wendy Wallner. I am CEO of a company called Balancing Life's Issues. We focus on employee engagement and health and wellness services, primarily for the Fortune 500.
Hi, I'm Tom Wharton. Work in consumer products also at General Foods down the road originally. Was CFO of the Maxwell's coffee business. Then we got into IT technology with CSC and Accenture. Right now I'm with a group called TechCXO, where we provide fractional part-time C-suite executives in young companies. I was co-chairman of a group called Executive Forum Angels, still actively involved in that. We've invested about $3 to $4 million over the last 8 years.
thanks for being here. Just a couple quick questions. How many folks in the audience have worked at a startup? Okay, or a corporate Fortune 5 or 100 company? All right, I saw your hands in both. Congratulations. How about a nonprofit? Okay, wonderful. So, just being in Westchester and being in other places throughout the country and coming back and seeing sort of the ecosystem that's starting to emerge, you know, community is always really important. But, you know, those different dynamics of companies are, you know, all partners in that ecosystem. There's a lot of investors and advisors and service providers that are a big part of this. But today, when you listen to the presentations or the pitches, I think it's important just to maybe always ask yourself how you can help. Maybe that's connected someone, to a prospective client or someone who might just be food for thought, new advice, someone in the industry. Maybe it's a subject matter expertise that you can bring to the table, or maybe it's just telling folks about other events in the area. So, you know, that's really, really important to stay together and to take it to the next level. So thanks to Deborah for that, for doing it already, and Les for bringing folks together. So I'd love to invite you back up to introduce Kara, and then I'll hand out some of the materials.
Okay, great. So I think I mentioned that, maybe I didn't, we have in the incubator right now, we have 8 startups. 4 are working on cancer discovery, drug development, and 3 are working on medical devices, and we have Kara. And Kara Sidero is the chief scientific officer for a company called Crave Crush, and Tammy's handing out her product, which is called Sweet Defeat, and she'll tell you about it. It's a very interesting nutraceutical that helps stop sugar cravings. And Kara's a great participant in the community of the incubators, very friendly. She's provided interns from campus, and we love having her there. And I'm so grateful that she's given us an hour of her evening to tell us about a great crush and Sweet to Eat.
Okay, hi everybody. I'm glad to be here tonight. So let's get started. The company is Sweet to Eat, and we're dedicated to helping millions of people eat less sugar and live happier, healthier lives. We are a New York City-based startup company. I'm listed at our leadership team. Our co-founder, Ariane Terry, is also president. Chief Technology Officer, Brian is our executive marketing director. We have some experts that work with us. Eric Spice is a neuroscientist. He's done a lot of clinical work for us. I'll get into that to demonstrate more about what our product does. And then we have our investors, Rob Goldstein, who's also co-founder, and Michael Lowe. So we have 2 brands, Crave Crush and Sweet Defeat. They have different marketing behind them, but they're the same product. What was handed out to you right now is a sample of our product. It's a lozenge that's clinically proven to reduce consumption of sugar and cravings for sugar. It's comprised of 5 high-quality plant ingredients, and it's safe, effective, it totally works. Do not try it now, because you will not enjoy it. Well, you can try it now, but it might, you might not enjoy it.
If we serve dessert.
Well. Yeah.
So we won't eat the dessert.
Yeah, you won't eat the dessert. Okay. So our story pretty much is, that's why, yeah, she was said that up front, right? I mean, our story is, why does one bite of sugar make us want to have more sugar? Why are so many people eating sugar, and is there a way to help control that? Here are just some stats that we've collected. We were at an expo, and we actually put together this slide. It's a picture here of how much sugar the average American consumes every year. That's 150 pounds of sugar. 85% of Americans say they have a sweet tooth, the same amount when we stop eating sugar. So why does one bite of sugar make us crave more? Well, if I can find a video that explains it better than I can, let's watch this 2-minute clip from this video.
Picture warm, gooey cookies, crunchy candies, velvety cakes, waffle cones piled high with ice cream. Is your mouth watering? Are you craving dessert? Why? What happens in the brain that makes sugary foods so hard to resist? Sugar is a general term used to describe a class of molecules called carbohydrates, and it's found in a wide variety of food and drink. Just check the labels on sweet products you buy. Glucose, fructose, sucrose, maltose, lactose, dextrose, and starch are all forms of sugar. So are high fructose corn syrup, fruit juice, raw sugar, and honey. And sugar isn't just in candies and desserts. It's also added to tomato sauce, yogurt, dried fruit, flavored waters, or granola bars. Since sugar is everywhere, it's important to understand how it affects the brain. What happens when sugar hits your tongue? And does eating a little bit of sugar make you crave more? You take a bite of cereal. The sugars it contains activate the sweet taste receptors, part of the taste buds on the tongue. These receptors send a signal up to the brainstem, and from there it forks off into many areas of the forebrain, one of which is the cerebral cortex. Different sections of the cerebral cortex process different tastes: bitter, salty, umami, and in our case, sweet. From here, the signal activates the brain's reward system. This reward system is a series of electrical and chemical pathways across several different regions of the brain. It's a complicated network, but it helps answer a single subconscious question. Should I do that again? That warm, fuzzy feeling you get when you taste grandma's chocolate cake? That's your reward system saying, yes. And it's not just activated by food. Socializing, sexual behavior.
Okay, I just wanted to show that clip to kind of illustrate that we can't help it. We need sugar. We eat sugar, and then we want more. So our company is interested in trying to help solve this problem. And it turns out that there's a way to do it. There's a plant called Geneva Silvestri. I have it here. And this plant makes a class of molecules called Genevic acids, shown here. And they bind to sweet taste receptors, temporarily change the conformation of the receptor, and you can't taste sweet. But more importantly, this also stops cravings for sweet. I'm going to explain that a little more later. So this plant is commercially available. You can actually chew these leaves, that's what people do. And there are also these products on the market, but we wanted to make a product that was convenient for people, and that's how we designed this lozenge. We have developed a supply chain for the product. So the leaves are indigenous to Southeast Asia, India area, and then a commercially available extract is available. In the incubator space, we were able to develop a purification process in which we go from this extract to a highly purified extract. And we're able to do that on a very large scale now for our commercial production. And then from there, we take a portion of the extract and formulate it into lozenges. And that's additional work that we've been able to develop in the incubator space. Clinically, we've teamed up with Eric Seiss at the Oregon Research Institute. And we gave people a placebo lozenge as well as a lozenge that you have here. They didn't know what it was. You guys already know how it works. But they didn't have any information. And they took the lozenge and then they were presented with candy. And the people who took the lozenge were less inclined to go for the candy. Overall, 44% reduction in overall candy that was consumed during that study, which is a really big deal. And it's also supported that this data is clinically significant. So what are we doing to get the product out there? So we have a couple sales channels that we're doing right now. The brand Crave Crush is available through Amazon and also on the Crave Crush website. We're in retail with Crave Crush in New York City, specifically a few of these pharmacies, Wilmer and Zimmer, as well as Vitamin Shop. And marketing for Sweet Tea is a little bit different. We're doing this multi-channel marketing strategy. So we're looking at paid social, like Facebook and Instagram, doing some search engine optimization. We've worked with affiliates as well as influencers. We've done direct mail campaigns where we've physically sent out in the mail product as well as pamphlets about our product, and we're even in some doctor's offices. So we've been really crunching all of this data to help narrow down who our customer base really is to understand them better, and then from there further develop them and understand what's working in terms of attracting customers. So far, what's been really successful for us is we've had a lot of traction in our paid social channel. So these are some ads that have been really successful on Facebook and Instagram. And by successful, that means converting to sales. We're having really high click-through rates. So this is a lot of data that we mine in order to understand who our customers are and how to then serve them better. We've also been in the news as either Sweet Defeat or Great Crush. We got kind of listed the accolades here, but most recently we were in publication for Metro, and the title of the article is "Does Sweet Defeat Work on Sugar Cravings? I Tried It, Here's What Happened." And here's a quote that we really like: "With growing evidence that diet is a larger part of the weight loss equation, a subscription to Sweet Defeat could be worth your money. If sugar cravings are the major factor holding you back from your weight loss goals, it might be a better investment than your gym membership." So Sweet Defeat is working for people, and we're continuing to get the message out. And then here's a really another important part of what we're doing, because we really we want to help people and help people on their journey to eat less sugar. So these are unsolicited feedback that we've gotten from customers saying that this product is working for them. It's helping them eat less sugar. It's helping them lead healthier lives. That's our mission. And this one's really touching because this woman got the product for her husband who has really bad sugar cravings. He has cancer, and this product has really helped him. So I think I'm within my time, so I've given you all samples. I encourage you to try the product. We're always looking for feedback from customers. And the product's available at sweetdefeat.com. And here's kind of how we have our packaging lined up and our pricing. So that's it. I have my contact information at the bottom if anyone has any questions or wants to learn more.
Yeah, I guess since I'm the food guy, first of all, I love brand name. It's a really good brand name. So what's your margin on the product? Pretty good margin?
Yeah.
I think you did a really nice job of going through this. You know, as an investor, I'm interested. So really nicely done.
Thank you.
And you have traction, which investors are looking for.
I should have said we launched the product in January 2018.
Okay.
So we just
yeah, you're getting started. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Great.
When I look at the product, and you mentioned a little bit about target audience, it seems to me that there's potentially different target audiences. Focus on weight loss. So the reason you're focusing on weight loss rather than diet control for diabetics.
So a lot of it has to do with being able to support that with data. Because this is a nutritional supplement, we actually can't say without having clinical data to support it that it's for weight loss or for diabetics. So we kind of have to dance around it and say, this is used for sugar cravings, and then the rest can be interpreted. So if you eat less sugar, you're going to lose weight. There is some data in the literature for diabetics who take Gymnema. It does lower blood glucose levels. We don't have that data for our product, so we're not really pushing that yet. Maybe in the future we can target more diabetics, but right now we haven't been able to.
So one comment I make as a reformed type 2 diabetic, in remission, by the way, on the no drugs. When I see your claim about a 70-point drop overnight is frightening. Quite honest, I would take that out of there because I find that quite questionable, to be quite honest.
That's a good point. That's something a customer said. So
still your literature.
Yeah,
so
that's fair.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Could you go back to the slide where you showed the progression of the product from the leaves all the way?
This?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Talk to me about the process a little bit more in depth. I mean, starting with the leaves, how much of that raw material do you need to form X amount of the extract? And then when you boil it down to the next stage, what do you think? Talk to me about cost at each stage of the first.
Sure.
Process.
So the leaves are cultivated. We don't actually purchase the leaves, we purchase the extract. So the process to remove the leaves and extract is about 2% yield. It's very low. We start with the extract, and then we develop a process to go from extract to our purified extract. That yield is about, depends, let's say between 6 and 10%.
going from the commercially available extract to the purified extract.
That's correct.
Is that a patentable process? Do you have protection?
We have a provisional application on that right now, yes.
And what about the last stage?
The last stage? Yeah, so a portion, about 2 milligrams of the purified extract is then formulated into the lozenge.
What's the cost of that formulation? Is it a labor-intensive process?
No, it's not a labor-intensive process. It's a tableting process that you basically take our extract as well as a bunch of different, say, fillers and excipients. They blend around and then they're pressed into tablets. It's pretty industry standard for a process like that.
They skipped me. So what's your connection? Why are you doing this? What's your connection to this plot?
Well, I was working for a Fortune 200 company, doing marketing at the time, product management, and I was really interested in working for a startup company. And I went on Indeed and I used the only search term I know, organic chemistry, and I saw an opportunity that was around health and wellness, about entrepreneurship, about really trying, you know, something very different. It really got me excited about being involved in this. So I met with the co-founders and I went through a really rigorous interview process and I got the job. And for me, I'm just so grateful to be part of this mission. I believe in it. I love all the science behind what we're doing, because there can be a bad rap for supplement companies, but we just have such rigor behind our quality and the science that we do. And for me, I'm just passionate about being part of really trying to help people, putting a good product out there, and supporting it with quality science.
First of all, there's clearly a need for products like this, because even people don't realize even diet soda leads to sugar craving for the same reason that you said. I do have a question about your IP. You mentioned that you have a provisional patent from the commercial available extract to the purified extract.
We do, and we have an issued patent on our formulation.
On the formulation itself?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's what I want to know.
Yep.
Thank you.
Can you go back to the testimonials?
For
sure. Before you try to do that. So, have you ever had a sugar craving?
Me personally?
Yes.
Yes.
No, I'm okay,
yes.
You know.
Yeah,
I
no,
mean,
it's fine.
If people, and I understand you can't make the weight loss testimony, but I think the emotional part about wanting to not have that, I've seen your ads on Facebook, and
mm-hmm.
I've actually talked about your product and our wellness. I'm a huge believer in whatever it takes, right? So these are definitely not your best testimonials.
Okay.
I know some of them on Facebook I've been mine that are a lot more dramatic. I stay away from anything with the cancer because I feel that that is such a personal story, and I just feel like I'm not sure you want to put that there.
That's fair.
And the last thing I'll say is, you could turn the volume way up.
We do have one customer who lost like 60 or 80 pounds, and we're trying to reach out to him to see if he can use his likeness and to really tell his story, because it is pretty profound how he found this product, started using it, and he does have that weight loss story, but we're not quite there to make it truly public yet.
Right, I can see that. And then the other thing is that, one more tweet, is if you go to the slide about the gym membership, I really have to say in the wellness industry, we're really trying to separate out exercise and eating.
Yeah.
Because they're just totally unrelated, and all the studies show they're unrelated, and they have nothing to do with each other. So, you know, there are tons of people who go to the gym and do all kinds of things, and then they'll leave, want to get the Maylin cream cheese? Like, you know, I just think that, this part is a better investment in gym membership. Nothing to do with this product.
Okay.
It's a gym membership.
This was from a recent article that someone wrote about the product, so.
Give me his name and number, I'll talk to him.
Okay, that's fair. All right, thank you all. It's really good feedback.
One
sure.
I noticed on the back of the packet a couple of things that are interesting. First, use 2 to 3 times daily. What does that provide for somebody that, say, you know, once a day wouldn't provide?
So
how much do these cost each year?
They're about less than $1 each.
Okay.
Yeah, this is our pricing. So we are pushing a subscription model. The best pricing is at larger quantity at a prescription price. To answer the question you asked, we're suggesting that it's used after meals when you're having a craving. Is 2 to 3 a day better than 1 a day? It depends on your needs. So it's hard to say it's exactly one size fits all. Like for me, I get really bad sugar cravings after lunch. That's kind of the time where I want them. But it would really, I'd say it depends on where you are in your health journey and how bad you need the product.
Can you have too many?
We've done some safety studies on the product. I mean, too many, the problem would probably be the sorbitol, because sometimes that's going to give people some upset stomach. That one of them has 400 milligrams of sorbitol. You really need to take like 20 grams to have an issue. That would be over, that'd be 50 lozenges in a day. So if you're going to do that,
Thanks for that feedback. Is there anyone excited in the audience? Do you have any observations or insights here? We have about 2 minutes.
Great story. You didn't talk too much about the target audiences, but very aware of that tremendous problem with childhood obesity, and I mean it's not really a child-friendly package, but packaged a little differently, targeted towards the parent, I think that might be a very interesting opportunity also.
Thank you.
So,
gentlemen
in the back. Yes.
I have a question. Do you have to go through any type of like food or drug administration procedures, or like whenever I think about this thing, I think of like the side effects. Like I watch the commercials on TV, and they talk for 2 minutes about the product, but then there's a 20 minutes
right
about all the side effects. You're gonna have 3 ears and 2 heads and stuff. And
yeah. So
I'd be curious about all that kind of.
Okay, so this this is not a drug. It's not a synthetic product. It's a plant extract. The government says that back in 1994, they passed a law and they said supplements that are on the market right now can continue to be on the market. And this falls into that category. So it's been, this Geneva sylvestrate has been used for millennia in a lot of Ayurvedic medicine and things like that. We've done our own studies around safety and things look good. So the government does regulate us as a dietary supplement, and there's a code of federal regulation that we have to follow that makes sure that we're formulating correctly. What we say we put in is there. A lot of supplement companies in the 90s got a bad rap of actually not putting active ingredients in product. So there's been that, and there are a whole bunch of regulation that we have to follow, so we do, and we hold our vendors accountable for that by auditing them. So that process is pretty well locked down. Regarding the Geneva specifically, it's been used really forever, and our product is such a low dose too, compared to a lot of the other supplements on the market because we're high purity.
Last question.
Oh, yeah, okay. What is the safety regulation from where the leaves come from, made into the elixir before they come to the United States? That safety issue. And why do you have two names if they're identical? If they're actually identical, why crush and why sweeten the feed?
Okay, so.
And then one more.
Okay, I remember that. Okay.
And then. Are you outsourcing the manufacturing of this tablet, or is that being done in-house? How are you doing?
Okay, so first question, safety of the leaves. We test everything along the supply chain. So we test for what's there and what isn't there. What's there, we want to make sure the genetic acid appears certain quantities. That's what's there. What's not there? Pesticides, heavy metals, microbes, polyaromatic, hydrocarbons, all those things. So that's what we test to make sure they're not there. And at each step, we release. What's your second question?
The two names.
So when we first started, we launched in January of 2017 as Grape Crush, and then we decided to change branding. We brought on another investor, and now our new brand is Sweet Defeat, and we're looking to phase out Grape Crush and have one. And the third question is, do we do this in-house or outsource? We outsource the manufacturing. We have spent quite a lot of time and money finding the right partners who can help us with this process, and now we have a really good relationship with partners that we trust. And so to follow up with this gentleman asked about FDA regulation, we audit them and make sure that they're following all the appropriate regulations and good manufacturing practices. So we kind of have really good control of that supply chain now.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Working on Preston to get set up. You can talk about that. Just a quick note on Kara. You could line up after Tom because he's interested and talk to her more if you have any more questions there. So, just want to introduce Preston. He's been working with ICANN New York for a little while with Les and his team. He is working with a small team, and also his son, who couldn't be here, is out in California. They have some work out there and services out there. The name of, was it the water shop?
The water store.
So he has experience in renewables prior to launching this company. He was out in Hawaii running for several years, upwards of 10 years, running the water store with the water replenishment and whatnot. So that's great perspective. Want to welcome you and for you to take over, and we're interested in hearing your story.
Thanks, Dan. And thanks, Les, for putting on this event and inviting us and letting us participate. Also, Bio Inc., appreciate that. And now, judges, for your valuable time and the feedback. So go eat them. And if you're not, then I'm going to blame it on the wine. So, I did have wine.
Blame it on this.
I'm going to get a few packs. And I have a girlfriend, and she would probably appreciate that. So. Anyway, so I'm Preston Bloss. I'm one of the co-founders of Vulcan Reserve Power. And for the next events, I'm going to be addressing a long overdue topic, in our opinion, and that's resiliency, and particularly when it comes to the electrical power and dwelling inside the city dwelling environment. Let's see. Okay. So if you live or work in the city and you understand the vulnerabilities associated with power failure, maybe you understand it more than most, and especially during a critical event. So if the power fails, what do you do? Well, the New York City grid, fortunately, is rather resilient, and that's not necessarily the case in surrounding areas, or across the nation, or in other countries. So, all are very vulnerable and to weather, catastrophic weather and man-made events, and regardless of how resilient the grid is, especially here in New York. So anyone who may have felt the effects of the blackout of 2003 or Sandy or 9/11, they'll probably tell you that once was enough. So in New York City, as in most cities, there are no real backup power solutions for individual city tenants. So the most available products are either too large or too small in power and size and capacity. What Volta proposes is that we're proposing a product that is home-sized, office-sized, deployable through retail channels, and that are ready for adoption. So the problem here is really twofold. Okay. The other problem really is about adoption. So there are three barriers to adoption here, and it's utility interconnection, fire and safety through FDNY and FPA, and then site approval from the Department of Building. And really, when you're dealing with the Department of Building, it comes a nightmare when it comes to permitting inspection and site risk, citation risk. So our proposal in yellow, both is solution is regarding those three issues. We have to be able to plug into a standard electrical socket after the power panel, be below 20 kilowatt hours threshold to get that NFPA approval, and also operate right out of the box, requiring no additional or little to no additional. So, over the years, through customer discovery, we found that when living and working in the city, there's a whole different mindset concerning this particular topic. So for those living in the city during an outage, it's about A, being alerted to a power interruption, and then B, getting prepared for the duration of the outage. So it's not so much someone looking for something long term, rather they want to be able to just get a warning and have enough lead time to get ahead of it and maintain acceptable comfort levels. Two, they also look to maintain personal safety and security of their community for as long as possible. So what we're really talking about here is risk mitigation. And so the longer the risk, the longer the outage, the greater the risk. For healthcare independence, they have a even narrow window, and increasingly the risk increases exponentially. So above all, this is an insurance policy. And if given the option, everyone would want the ease that comes with just knowing that they have something. Okay, so what we're proposing, our solution is the Volta Reserve, Volta Urban Power Stack. And right there we have a few features. Easy installation. So what we have here is we as pictured there, it's quick and easy installation into a 120 volt outlet. And then all-in-one appliance, so that there's no need for additional components. And then the sleek and slim design, which is perfect for limited spaces and functional living areas. Optional touchscreen for on-site and daily engagement. And of course, smart software. I'm sure to speed through this a little bit more. Okay, so briefly a little bit about us. We started out in 2014 as a father and son team. We're Delaware LLC. We're headquartered in Long Island, and we've been at this for about 4 years since. We're a self-funded bootstrap startup, and we've been working with ICANN for ever since. And so recently we've been accepted to the New York Best Incubator as recently as fall 2017. So our starting target market is New York. That's it's in our blood, it's in our backyard, and it's what we know. So our starting focus is directed toward the higher end owner occupied luxury condo apartment unit dweller, as well as the small retail and office based business owners. This is represented, according to our estimates, about 48% of the almost 3 million property units in New York City, or 1.4 million unit potential addressable market. So we feel that this is a great and significant starting point for us. Our market size, well, to put things in perspective, we have an almost 1.5 million unit market here in New York. And according to our conservative analysis, there's a 7.8 million unit serviceable market for residential light commercial spaces across 25 major US cities and Toronto, Canada. Just to consider the numbers very quickly, in 2016, the backup power market was valued at about $6 billion. Global projections for 2021 go up to $19 billion. And then similar for the IoT where the global market valuation is $44 billion for 2016 and projected to surge to $53 billion by 2022. I'll call me up in a moment. So our customer, who is that? This is a little bit of a snapshot. We're looking at 45 and over, upper middle to upper income, and their prime motivators really are comfort and safety, medical device dependent, and their preservation of business, as well as risk mitigation. So let's look at competition a little bit. So as a disruptor in this urban power market, we do expect competition. And so first, as first market, we want to be about brand, quality, and service, and that's going to be our distinction. Although indirectly, we've identified the top five related more well-known brands. A lot of you might be familiar with Tesla, and that's what I get all the time. They all pretty much do the same thing when it comes to backup power and solar support. That's the basic function of an ESS. The all-in-one design, well, some claims do that, but you know, I think that's more open to opinion. Either way, they all need additional components to function. So where we separate ourselves is when it comes to the quick and easy plug-in installation, smart home management, and integrated onboard intelligence. So same five companies for the price. We find ourselves pretty competitive, even though even on the higher end. And remember, our systems don't require any additional components, whereas most others do. So we try to reduce the overall cost to the consumer in that amount. I'm going to shut around this. Sorry. And so this is our team. My mugshot right there, and along with myself. My son, Devin Bloss. He's out in California. He has a background in PV solar and battery installation, electrician. He was an electrician for a while, and now he's working for a T2S Energy Engineering, out in Long Beach, California. He also has a background in CHP and microgrids. Jason Johnson, he's our software guru. And he has a 20-year background as well. Financial standard, financial projection. We're aiming to be established by year two of the market entry and well on our way to currently other U.S. markets by Q4 of 2020. By Q1 of 2023, we hope to have established a significant U.S. presence. Have already crossed the border to penetrate other global markets as well. Not included are prospective domestic and international licensing agreements. So what we're doing is we're seeking some seed funding in the form of $500,000 based on what we're able to procure. The basic use of funds will be broken into roughly what you see there, and the majority will be going probably towards the further development. The physical product and establishing a presence in New York. And this is basically a summarization of the slide, so I can put that short of the line. And that's pretty much it at this point. I can answer your questions.
First, maybe you can illustrate for us how typical this is.
So typically, we're trying to come in within the size constraints that are applicable for an apartment. So it's roughly 45 inches high, maybe 30 inches wide, and we're trying to get as close to 6-inch depth as possible. When you're dealing with New York City apartments, square footage is paramount.
Does it get hot, or do we store it in a closet, or does it need to have its own space?
We're working on the technology as we go through this alpha prototype stage, but it is going to not require much in terms of cooling. We're good with acid, even though it's lithium. So we're dealing with lithium iron phosphate, so it's the safest issue.
How long a charge do you have in the aperture permit?
Well, I was at that, and the real answer is it's based on consumption. So if we're talking to a general audience like we are, then say 2 days. But again, if you're plugging in your cell phone, it could probably go longer. If you're plugging in your refrigerator and a couple lights, then maybe come in into that space. If you put the whole house on it, well, then you probably burn through a lot.
Do you have any proven success?
Well, we've had to cut it short a little bit, but we've been consulting in the battery space for the last 4 years now. The industry is pretty new still, and you can tell when it comes to lithium, they don't even have a full 10 years of data for our particular chemistry.
But has any of your product, is that the right word?
Yeah, we're still in
ever been through a blackout and been used?
We're still in the prototype.
Still in the prototype.
Yeah, we're still working on the
prototype. You showed that you're going to make, you're almost break even in 2018, the 50%.
That's the, we're projecting that.
But then you have like a 54% margin 5 years later, either.
We're hoping that as we increase our volumes and our costs come down, and also we're.
I would think it'd be much greater
than that. Well, we're trying to be conservative.
Yeah.
Hello? Any more comments from the panel?
Yeah, come over. Where are you? What is proprietary or potentially patentable?
Well, we have provisional patent filed, and we have it filed for the overall system together. Because we're not really reinventing the wheel, right? So this is kind of like a large GPS system, but it's more intelligent and it covers a variety of loads. It has more power behind it. But in terms of IP, most of our protection is going to come with the software.
Speaking of the software, Preston, the smart technology, what about it is smart? In other words, what is the app? It's going to be driven by an app. So what does the app actually do?
So when it comes to the focus tonight was really mainly on the bones. Is home energy storage, because that's what really matters to most people in the city. But the idea of integrating smart home technology, that was really to add more value and granularity when it came to controlling their energy consumption. So it would operate much like some of the smart device management systems that are out now. However, it's going to be a little bit more energy-centric.
Can you put the competitive back on?
I'll try.
Selling those now? And they're selling them?
They're selling, but they're not selling in the States just yet. It's the last I checked.
Okay. But LG's doing it.
LG, they just started having a presence in the US, I think. I don't think they have much in terms of distribution. What's hot right now is the Australian market, because they have a big energy problem there, and that's where everybody's kind of focusing.
I'm just, I don't want to discourage you, but you know, how you compete against LG, what is it that you have?
Well, all well, these guys, see, the reason why we make these are the closest to what we have. A lot of what you know, is out there is more or less in direct competition. But I'm not gonna say I don't have any competition. These guys could enter the market one day.
Yeah.
What we're proposing is, aside from these guys who are more on the solar support, we're looking to really enter the urban space, and so we want it to be plug-in. When we were installing the Teslas out west, it was a nightmare. You know, the first ones, the second ones are better. The first ones were basically about the box of batteries, and they had to you know get inverters, and then they had to get to talk to each other. So there's a lot of challenges. So we were able to see what works and what didn't, and that's really what. I think what we kind of what really sets us apart. Could we use our systems for solar support? Absolutely. But we're focusing more on the unaddressed market out in the cities.
Whenever you make a pitch, time is
I know.
And so I always feel that way because you always need more time. So it's pick and choose, right? The market share slide to May is that's a crucial minutes if you don't need. Everybody knows your market share. We know everyone's your market share. So that was at least. Now you're like awesome right now. This bogged you down.
Yeah.
So because it's a prototype, to me it's we're looking at you. What's your passion? What's your connection? I think most investors would say that they're looking at the person. And so I would do away with all those market share slides because I mean everyone's. Potentially could be a customer, right?
Oh, absolutely. Sure.
I want to follow up on that, though, because something you said was you kind of danced around something I think can be very important to your pitch. My first reaction when I saw it is, why wouldn't I want this for my house instead of working with a generator? That was the first reaction. Yeah. And then I started thinking about it some more, and I said, why would you pick apartments? Because you can't have a generator.
Correct.
Okay. I didn't hear the rationale why this is a unique niche. That's what you're focusing on. And I think that's very, very important in your marketing
strategy. It's actually in there.
I know it's in there. I heard it.
I couldn't get it.
But I had to drag it out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
to figure it out.
If
we focus, I mean, I think that's an interesting niche because I don't think anybody would follow us. I lived in the city for years. A 27th floor of an apartment. I would never think of what would happen, you know, if there was a power failure when I was in the 27th floor of an apartment. But you know,
yeah.
Actually, you know, especially with these expensive condos, $6,000 is nothing to those people. You know, it's not a big deal, but it would give them a peace of mind.
Are you doing his pitch, Ron?
I'm trying to.
Yeah.
It's actually today's worth per charge, right? How do you recharge it? What's that process?
Well, it's
people buy two of them.
It's basically, oh yeah, so it's basically plugged right in. Because what we're doing is branding it as a is an appliance,
right?
So we want to take it to a remote retail market. So if we have to get it installed, then now you're talking about any issues, things like that, all the things that we want to go with. So if we're plugging into the system, somebody can easily go to the store, pick one up. And then drag it up to their apartment, plug it in, and do it to go. If you have to get it sold, like all these other companies, or the products, rather, then, you know, it kind of defeats the purpose, and you would fly in soon.
Let's just do one thing side by side. I'm sorry, just real quick. And we'll use Samsung as an example. Samsung is a $12,000 product. I don't know all the mechanics of the Samsung unit, but let's just say it's, for the sake of argument, it's kind of close to what you guys are producing. This is comparable in some way. How long does that last before that's out of the juice?
You know, they all vary. again, because they're really geared to solar support for the most part, it's always replenishing. If it was to act as a backup power, you know, a lot of these guys, they have multiple versions of the product.
Is that usable in an urban setting? Is that more of a...
It really isn't, yeah, because they have to be hardwired in and require drug control and stuff like that. However, I will say that when I made this slide, I tried to pick, in terms of capacity and power, I tried to pick ones that were close. So it chances out that they're within a few kilowatt hours of the system.
Sorry, so that, yeah.
Yeah, so you haven't, you know, it's very simple, you just plug it in, so I assume it's just a big battery on a trickle charger.
Basically, yes.
And then you haven't discussed how you get the power out. And what I don't think you can do is hardwire it into an apartment, so there's no transfer switch. So everybody has to then go plug their refrigerator into this thing, okay? So I don't see what your smart software does for you, because all it can do is say, okay, the thing is charged, and you don't need software for that, the triple charger would do that. Or it can say, oh, the electricity's out, go plug your refrigerator into this. All software can do is beep. So, are you telling people that you got to run 12, you know, extension cords into this thing, you know, to get any power out?
Well, I could spend a lot of time on this. The way we're designing it is twofold. You can either plug into the pop-out outlets that are on board, or you can hardwire it.
But can you hardwire it so that there's a transfer switch and stuff? Because you can't run power from this back into the wall.
No, you can't, but you can run it to a subcritical panel, in which case you can run home runs to those critical loads.
Okay, so someone has to install another sub-panel in their house.
It's that option, yeah.
Over here?
Yeah, so it's actually kind of a similar question. So it's kind of like a UPS battery backup for a computer. So would people keep it plugged in all the time, just charging, and then have whatever they want powered, if the power goes out, plugged in all the time so that it would then kick on and power those things? Or would they be charging it? And then the second part of that is, what kind of effect does this have on an electric bill if somebody has it plugged in all the time?
Okay. Well, there's a few things there. If you can have hardwired. If you do, then yeah, it would operate much like that, very autonomously. And then you receive an alert on your device, and then you can take whatever steps you need to do. Very simple. However, if you did live in the city, most people are just looking for anything. So if it is a situation where they need to run an extension cord, even though it's inconvenient, it still gets them through that outage. However, if you had it in, say, a residential home, and it was hardwired into your home, then at that point, you could participate in, say, demand response, maybe demand response aggregation program, or just use it as a time of use where you're offsetting your peak usage.
One more question. There was a gentleman in the back. Did you have a question? No? Okay, one more. Yes?
I own and manage apartment buildings and copes and condos, so I'm pretty familiar with this kind of stuff.
Partnership.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Well, but my concern is the load on the building's electrical use in that. And I think I might sort of start there, where you said you needed to get building department approvals and things like that.
Right.
Because I would be concerned, first of all, if you're going to hardwire stuff, you have to worry about the owners of rentals, whether you'll be able to, tenants get permission to allow them to hardwire it. You might have an obstacle there, and also...
Well, if you're going to hardwire it,
yeah.
That's why we have the on-site plugs.
But I would worry about the plug-in in terms of the load on the apartment, whether you use it to be too much load, whether that will trip the... circuit, especially in older buildings where some of them still haven't even converted from circuit breakers to fuses. And
oh, right.
Yeah.
And the third concern I would be concerned about would be the battery itself and how safe it is, and is there an automatic cutoff when it's fully charged, because the battery situations, as you're reading now, could cause fires and things like that.
EMS usually handles all that.
Sounds like a follow-up conversation, because that's good feedback.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Let's forget. forgot to tell you that before you leave the room, you must sign up to test this in your home. So we need at least 20 signatures. As we get Jesse ready to go, there's also, you know, more water and you know, food and beverage and whatnot. If you want to get, you know, keep having some of that. But Jesse and I met a couple years ago. He was starting Crew Street. If you look it up at just one point, you might also find Crew Street Media. At one point, they changed rivalries. Yeah. So, you know, we're interested to hear your story about it.
Thank you very much. Yeah. First of all, thank you everybody for hearing me. This is a great opportunity. This is actually my first pitch. I launched the company in January of this year. Last year, I was an executive. At this time, I was an executive for a company in the Midwest, about $100 million a year business owned by a private equity firm. I was hired for the purpose of transforming the business to become more data-driven. What I found in that process is that the options to change a business to become more data-driven are pretty much locked into the largest 10 or so firms that control the space. So what I want to do is build a firm that can enable every business, even in the SME, small and medium enterprise market, to be able to do those innovative things. So I'm going to try to skip through some of these superfluous slides. I think 10 minutes is going to ask for that. I'll quickly tell you a bit of our mission. Crew Street, Digital, helps organizations unlock the power of their data to drive growth by treating information as an asset and creating systems to support that data. We want to function as the chief data officer on demand while empowering organizational leaders to accomplish greater no matter where they are on their journey. This is a great little article. It was referencing an article from a visual capitalist that talks a bit about the importance of the CDO for an organization, chief data officer for a healthcare organization, educational organization, particularly organizations that are dealing with disruption, is going to be more important than ever in the next couple of years. In fact, according to the article, 90% of large global organizations will have a CDO by 2019. The role of a CDO is going to be a data integrator, business optimizer, market innovator. And what we want to do, and Gartner also references in a lot of the studies they've referenced lately, and what we want to do is essentially provide a fractional service for an organization in this way. In fact, I was very lucky to get an audience with Doug Laney at Gartner, who's the CDO at Gartner, to give him a sense of my business model. He felt like it was sort of an emerging space. Crew Street, our goal is to put in place business leaders and technology leaders that can bridge the divide between technology and marketing, and in many cases even the financial aspect of the business. We do this through a strategic alignment with corporate goals, doing audits on technology, and making sure that those things align with the expectations of the business. The team is comprised of me, two of my brothers who are former business owners and business leaders, as well as two other partners. My VP of Technology, Asim, who was a big data architect for Experian for 14 years, and my head of client strategy and sales, Michael, who has worked at Experian and done at Bradstreet, creating enterprise solutions for the Fortune 1000. So the challenge right now, more than ever, is that marketing and business in general is transforming. Data is exploding everywhere, and people are having a hard time making sense of it. Personalization is becoming more and more important. In fact, my last year at Axiom, where I was the head of the agency group, we were putting together solutions even for healthcare insurance firms like Anthem, who wanted to have really firm understanding of all the various insurers that were coming through their ecosystem, and be able to personalize even recommendations for personal care. So becoming relevant and using data to do that is becoming more important than ever. This is a marketing technology landscape. I'm sure you've seen this. Making sense of this and how data flows through this is becoming more and more critical for businesses. And what we're really focusing on is changing the way business is done. In the old days, we'd create an operational data store. We'd look at say, hey, here's a part of the business we need to spin up a database for. We need to do this thing and just kind of gut reaction. Leaders today, CEOs, CIOs, are saying, no, we need to look at how this plays a role in the bigger picture. How are we leveraging the data, and what data do we not understand, within our business model. In fact, Citibank just recently put out a job offer, not a job offer, a which is to hire a chief data officer. And what you'd see in this job offer here is that it aligns perfectly with the goals of our organization. Organizations need data-driven business leaders, and it's not just a technology question anymore. The problem, of course, is data, right? I mean, you've got people coming in from various channels, email, website, you name it, and on top of that, the types of data that are coming are really kind of challenging. In this case, we have Rebecca Smith, and I'm going to reference 10 times here. She may come in one source as anonymous, another as Becky, another as Rebecca, and on top of that, she may have had three different addresses in the last 3 years. Understanding that data and how it applies to an organization and how to have a relationship with Rebecca is critically important. So really the focus needs to be bringing that down to a meaningful way to see business, which is essentially focusing on this, the single source of truth, which is your single database where you're basically focusing on having a single view on your customer, 360 review. Connectivity is also critically important, which essentially means that I can take Jesse Cruz, and because the data I have is so good and current on Jesse Cruz, I can onboard him into the digital ecosystem which exists and reach Jesse no matter where he is, no matter what channel, no matter what technology he's in, I can reach him in a meaningful way. Recently spoke to a chief information officer at a big hospital system in Boston who basically said about 3 years ago they hired a data scientist to implement their data strategy, and it was the best investment they've made in years. So let me tell you a bit about our solution. Our solution is a combination of service and technology. I have been building essentially a list of experts in the field who are our chief data officers that report to me in any given engagement. Our chief data officers oftentimes are executives, like this guy here, John Hess, former executive at JP Morgan, Bank of America, who essentially understands the business intent behind our clients that may function in this financial services firm. This is something I need to do for healthcare. I haven't done it yet, but I will do it. Our CEOs are actually incentivized to work with our partners and our internal systems. That we actually pay them more to give better solutions. We're building a middleware and an administrative UI that allows us to integrate with partners, like an analytics partner that we recently signed and a data services partner that we recently signed. They do two things. One, our data services partner allows us to compute data on any given data set and to organize that data. And then we can then, from our ecosystem, kick it over to our analytics partner, which is a team of essentially analysts, PhD level analysts, that can run this data set kind of size through an analytics platform and create insights. A quick example is we've got multiple levels of modeling. Cluster analysis, regression, semantic analytics. I'll explain this to any of you if you want after, but at a simple level, we talk about regression, which is essentially mean scoring for the purposes of understanding who's the most important in your models. This can take 40 to 80 hours. We can do this now. For example, a university may say, hey, we want to understand the best student prospects that are coming through our lead funnel. We need to build a model that leverages our data and your data to better rank and prioritize. This is an example of a deal. Because our partner is actually overseas, but all of the technology is US-based, we can leverage our cost benefit, in this case it's about $3,300 for this model, and deliver a model. I mean, this is probably well below market value at $10,000, and still make $7,000 on a single engagement. This is gonna deliver insights and lead scoring for an organization in the mid-market that they've never had access to before because the big companies don't allow it. I'm going to skip this, but let's just say this is our data. We have a lot of data services that are available to us now through our ecosystem that we recently put in place. Our competition are the likes of Accenture, Axiom, Deloitte, Epsilon, Info Group, Merkle, big companies that essentially walk in and say, hey, it's $100,000 to talk to one of our consultants, and then we'll do business with you. In our case, we don't think that's necessary. Right now, our target market is companies that are going through mergers and acquisitions. organizations that are industries that are being disrupted, such as publishing, education, and healthcare. Our biggest client right now is in publishing, one of the big four publishing firms, and we're basically building them a custom customer database. Finally, organizations that know they've got a lot of data and they know that they're not monetizing it properly. I'm going to skip this. I would tell you that we have a great big plan for funding. I would say the simple answer to that is we've got some ambitious plans. We've got big contracts pending. Once we've proven out our model, we're going to be very excited about talking about funding. I think at this point, we're only 6 months in and we're enjoying the ride. So thank you for your time.
As a lawyer, are you actually collecting data or simply managing data?
Yeah, both. So part of the challenge with a lot of firms that want to get in this space is that you need to go through an NSA and a lot of hoops to be able to get the ability to manipulate somebody's data. If I, as a small firm, can get back to that place, then I'll have the ability to take in your data, you're a big firm, medium-sized firm, and manipulate it either on your system or on my system, and enrich it and complete that data. So both options are there. Primarily, we would love to have you on our system because that's the best way to do it. Now, the good news is, because my head mark, my head of technology, worked on an anonymized hashing technology with his experience, we actually have sort of proprietary knowledge on privacy data distribution. So we know how to anonymize the hash, do all of the analytics on our side of it without ever giving up any PII and then giving it right back to the client.
Are you partnering with compliance teams?
Yes. So we have a partner we just signed who is essentially a primary source data aggregator who sells data to the likes of the big firms like the Axioms and Experience, Oracle, LexisNexis. They are small, lean, and unknown, so it's to our benefit. And it allows us now to basically leverage their data. They've got a full cut of the entire U.S. consumer file.
When I think of data, I think of data being a living thing, not a discrete point in time.
Absolutely.
So I can see you guys coming in and setting something up. What is your business model for an ongoing relationship with your
client? Absolutely, I think it's a great point. So I'll give you a quick example. A model build for a client, like one that we delivered actually prior to this organization, client did Experience, was where we built a model, highly sophisticated lead model that included both the data from them and us. Hosting the model, we were able to constantly feed that data with real-time consumer data and behavioral data. So that kind of an example is a recurring model. We're going to be constantly seeing hosting revenue, model revenue, and even rebuilds. So yes, great point.
So I think this is a crowded space right now.
Totally. Yep.
So I think that if you're going to own the competitive slide, that is one side of the competitive slide, but the agencies are all over this too.
It gets great feedback. So my last role, head of advertising for OnCourse Learning, I essentially was at nurse.com, the largest nursing community in the country. So the 75% of the clients we dealt with every day were agencies across all 50 states. All of them told me, Jesse, I'm data driven. I flew across the country and I presented solutions that I put in place. And 9 times out of 10, they would say, wow, I didn't know that was possible. So all the agencies will tell you they're data driven. The fact of the matter is, click-through rates are not, don't make you data driven.
So just like the gentleman before, and I just forgot his name, I apologize.
Preston.
You are so much better right now than the slide deck. I mean, you know, for me, I've been named to the best server a long time. I think the passion that the person brings to the table is key.
Thank you.
The slide decks are holding you guys up.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it, I don't know if it's practice there, not being judgmental, but you walk away and you're like, oh, you're a smart cat, like you get that. But this, it was like.
But I just want to add that, sorry, Tom, I just want to say one thing about what Wendy's saying. I find when I coach businesses on making their deck, that really the most important slide is about the true problem you're solving.
Right.
And usually the entrepreneur's passion is directly linked to the problem, because you get your idea from being intimately associated with the problem, knowing there's no solution, and building a solution. And so, assuming you stay close to customer discovery and you test your solution, that's really, I think, ties in with what Wendy's saying. That's where your love for it comes out, that's where your journey started, and that's what's moving you forward. And that really encapsulates almost all the other elements. If you can tell what the problem is from your intimate knowledge of the problem and how you're addressing the solution, it really makes your presentation come alive, usually, because that's what you love about it. I would recommend that people start their presentations from that place. I'm doing this because I understand this problem, because these are the elements of the problem, and here's my solution.
And I'm a tad better than anyone else. Like, it's the one time that I feel a little just a little spice. Like, you know, you bring that to it, right? Like, do you believe you're better?
I do, yes.
Just a little?
I feel a lot better.
There you go.
I think what your focus is on is the middle market too, which I think is really key. I was just having this conversation with an investment banker about trying to sell businesses, and these, you know, baby boomers are trying to sell the business. They've never taken advantage of that data.
Absolutely.
They don't know what they have.
Absolutely.
And it's a great value, and the ability to come in, work with you, and the multiples can go up.
Absolutely. Yeah, so, that's I appreciate that feedback. That was the, you know, when I was at Axiom, it was, we worked on Fortune 1000.
Yeah, you're talking Accenture and, you know.
Yeah, and it was like, you see these people trying to put these things in banging their head against the wall, trying to make it work. And then you can go talk to a mid-market company, $100 million in business, and they'd be like, what is this? I didn't even know this existed.
Right.
So this is, and to your point on passion, I mean, I got here thinking I was going to tell you all about my business with the specifics, and then I started thinking, you know, what people are probably going to wonder why I decided to leave a Christian corporate job and start a business. And it was because there's a problem out there. People don't know how to solve it.
Again, building on both points over here, I think you really need to focus on what your niche is for, that mid-market niche. I mean, the first thing I thought of, asking out there, all those guys are out there. You're a little guy, the hell are you doing out there? It's the first thing I focus on now, having run several mid-market businesses in my lifetime and faced with the possibility of trying to put SAP at the you fully understand how scared you are of bringing one of the time off the radar centers. There's a consulting business doing all SAP stuff, man, you're scared by that because you have limited resources, both from a personnel point of view and a financial point of view, both. And you really need somebody like you who says, don't worry about it, just give me this stuff.
That's right.
I'll show you how to do this. And at the end of the day, you're going to be paid back 10 times because you're going to be much more efficient. That goes to what you said earlier, too, is that here's my passion, here's my frustration. There's millions and billions of dollars worth of valuable data, and actually goes to your point about selling the company too. You know, that's what goodwill is. Especially in this day and age, it's all this wealth of information that's sitting inside these companies that nobody knows how to get to or manage. And that, you have a wonderful target, I think, that you need to focus on.
Any comments, questions, observations from?
Hi, Danny. The most interesting and informative and entertaining presentation came from Dr. Cesario. However, all of the presenters, although they had great presentations, suffer from too much information on the slides. So you have to boil it down, make it a lot more succinct. That way it'll have much greater impact. Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay.
All right.
you know, some more networking, feel free to, share thoughts and business cards and whatnot, and thanks for coming.